We move on to the next speaker.
Then we have the third speaker, Dr. Sujith Chandy. He is going to talk to us on the practices in the pharmacy towards patient safety. Dr. Sujith Sujith Chandy has done, I think, his PhD in global health, Karolinska University, Sweden. And he has assumed certain positions before he left us. He was a professor of clinical pharmacology and head pharmacy CMC Vellore, and also medical pharmacology at Oman Medical College. He is currently a group director, CPMM Siloam Hospital, Jakarta, in Indonesia. He has won several awards, which is listed here. And he has been a resource person for medicine safety and management, pharmacovigilance, pharmacology education. And he has several international collaborations that he has worked with. And he has a number of publications and contributions to his credit. And we are happy that Dr. Sujith is going to speak to us on practices, best practices in the pharmacy towards patient safety. Yes, Dr. Sujith.
Thank you. I have a challenge, and that's already it's a postprandial afternoon session with a heavy lunch, and you've already had three speakers in front of me. And so I'm just going to try and get a little survey just to wake you up a bit. How many of you here have taken a medicine in the last 1 year? Please stand up. Please stand up. Please stand up. If you've taken a medicine in the last 1 year, please stand up. Please stand up. I didn't ask you to sit down. This is Simon Says. Okay. All right. Now, for those who... Wait. I'm going to ask you to stand up. The next question is coming. So there are people here who have not taken a medicine in the last 1 year. Okay, interesting. In your immediate family, if nobody has taken a medicine, you can remain seated. The rest, please stand up. Those are sitting. If any of your immediate family have taken medicines in the last 1 year, please stand up. Okay, right, all right. Okay, now, the second and last question is, if any of you have taken a dangerous medicine, please rotate both hands. All right. If any of you have taken an entirely safe medicine, please rotate your whole body. Okay.
There is some safety issue
there. Everyone, absolutely. Everyone can sit down now. Now, it is a very surprising thing. I didn't realize there'd be people who haven't taken a medicine in the last 1 year. I initially thought I'll ask for 1 week, and then I went to 1 month, and then I went to 6 months, and then I thought, okay, let's make it 100% 1 year. But there are some people who haven't taken a medicine. We need to immediately open up and do an autopsy on them, right, and see what is so magic about them. Okay, now, if you still haven't woken up, let me just tell you that in your life, you're going to take a medicine. And it's interesting that one person realized that the medicine that he or she took was dangerous. And it's interesting that not many people were of the view that about safe medicines. So it's a very, very difficult topic, but it's a personal topic. Even if you're not an administrator, you or your family are going to take a medicine. Now, the other aspect is, I have a difficult challenge. Some of you are medical and some of you are non-medical, though all may be associated with a hospital. So forgive me for those who think this presentation is very elementary, especially the medical people. And forgive me for those who think that this presentation is very hard, especially the pharmacology part for the non-medical people. I have tried to maintain a neutral balance and try to talk about both aspects. Coming to the hospital, I've already spent 3 minutes on this, but I think it's worth it. You know, besides clinical judgment and surgical errors, I think the one thing which can kill a patient is the medicine. Right? Now, it poses an inherent risk, the actual medicine itself, But it also has an external risk, because we as people are the ones prescribing, dispensing, or administering, or using the medicine. So let me talk about inherent risk first. I do realize that this may not be really part of the title which was given to me, but I think you have to realize it in order to make sure that you invest in your pharmacies and safety within the pharmacy. And not just the pharmacy, by the way, because medicines are used throughout the hospital and outside the hospital because of the hospital. So let's just talk a bit about adverse drug effects, quality issues, high caution medicines. And I'll explain that a little later. If it was a purely medical audience, I would try and ask you what these are due to, but I'm not going to. All I can say is that I vouch for it, these were due to medicines. Some kill, some don't. But the thing is, interestingly, they can affect people who've not taken the medicines also. Forgive me for showing this, but these poor children never took that particular medicine which causes. You might think the last one, the smile there, not much, but that poor child may have psychosocial implications where they cannot smile for their life due to the black staining teeth of tetracycline. So there are different types of adverse drug effects. Again, I don't need to go into it. And there is a science to this which we call pharmacovigilance. The point really is, and I have to stress this to all of you, if a doctor prescribes you new medication, totally just been discovered in the market, and they will prescribe to you new medication because it's more costly and more profitable and you won't know about it, so you think the doctor is smart, right? But the point is, these are the most dangerous medicines because the clinical trials on which it has been done prove efficacy, not the dangers. And unfortunately, if a country does not have a proper pharmacovigilance system to report these side effects, what will happen is that you may have a situation where these bad side effects go unnoticed in the population until somebody reveals it or does a good study on it. So for example, recently, the last 10 years back, all of us were addicted to terfenidine and anastomozole, non-sedative antihistamines for our cold and cough. But they've been withdrawn because now we've discovered they have caused arrhythmias. So there are various examples on this. So there is a pharmacovigilance system which reports, which analyzes. In India today, we do have a pharmacovigilance program which kick-started in 2003, fell flat by 2005, again kick-started in 2010-11, and now it is on the roll. But they are doing their best, I can assure you. But the fact is that there's under-reporting, because people are not aware that you should report, or people don't want to report, or it's not part of our culture. So many of the medicines which are being trashed into our country because they are banned in other countries, we don't know the side effects actually. But WHO does have a system, and in Uppsala Monitoring Center, UMC, and through a software called Vigibase, we can develop signals. For example, the antihypertensive captopril, when it came to the market, no one knew it caused cough, and therefore you can't give it to asthmatics and people with bronchitis. But because of the signal system, now we know. Quality issues, again, affects all of us. A few years back, Tamil Nadu was rocked with a quality scam where expired medicines were recirculated. I do know that there are one or two districts in certain parts of India, which I will not name, because I don't want to offend anybody, but their major industry is counterfeit medicine. So counterfeit medicines are when there's no active ingredient. We have to be careful in our hospitals to make sure that we wet all our products and make sure there's no counterfeit medicine. Difficult, because if you look at that picture, you really can't make out which is fake and which is authentic. So we have to know where our suppliers are coming from, where these companies are, what are they manufacturing, is it outsourced? Some of the multinationals are actually outsourcing to other companies. And we have to study this in great detail. as you know, in India, unfortunately, we can manufacture any certificate we want. So we have to be careful with this. But what worries me more, especially in hospital setup, is the substandard medicines. When the amount is supposed to be 50 milligrams, but it might be less. Now, this could be due to various factors like storage, something wrong in the manufacturing setup, humidity. Could be various factors. But it could also be due to brand variations. Now, a few years back, when I was going through our tender system, ciprofloxacin, a usual antibiotic that all of us take, we had 112 quotations. 112 companies were quoting to us. So you can imagine the variation which is theoretically possible in these brands. Fortunately, there are good companies and we are able to isolate, okay, these are the good, possibly the good brands. But again, we're not 100% sure. So that's another thing which could impact safety, especially the pharmacokinetic safety. Damage. All of us know some of our pharmacies are not entirely in the right places in a hospital, maybe not with the right environment, with the right temperature, etc., and maybe not with the right handling, so damage can occur. Now, I don't know, what do you think is the temperature in this auditorium at the moment? Maybe 24, 25 centigrade? Well, medicines are just like people, they get affected by temperature. And you've got to understand that sometimes they can degenerate with temperature, especially above 35, 40, 45. Now, in fact, the label of the medicine will say room temperature, but actually the room temperature means 25 degrees. So we are going way above that in our summer situations. Now, I like to use the word high caution rather than high risk or high alert, because drugs inherently have a problem. They need not always be safe. And this could be due to the safety margin which I've put in the in this graph, where the therapeutic effect is with this particular dose, the toxic effect is with another dose, and the wider the safety margin, the more safe the drug. But there are drugs which are very, very narrow. That means if you overdose slightly, the patient goes into toxicity. Now, the funny thing is, in JCI or NABH, all this is not talked about, only medication errors. And I think that's why I'm using this term high caution medicines, because from a pharmacological and pharmaceutical and pharmacy point of view, we have to make a list of high caution medicines based on the inherent risk also, and not just on the external risk. The second group of drugs which you have to be careful, so example of narrow therapeutic index is digoxin, for those of you who are medically oriented. Zero order kinetic drugs, all drugs, usually they employ first order kinetics, where you increase the dose and the amount which is excreted increases. But there are drugs which when you increase, it still excretes at a particular fixed concentration, like phenytoin, for example. So again, as soon as you overdose slightly, you land up in problems. These are not documented in many of the hospital safety lists. But we also need to talk about medication errors, potential misuse, and I'm going to talk about that now. Drug toxicity. I ask this question, are drugs safe for a particular reason? Actually, there is no single drug which is safe in the world. Let me assure you, even vitamin C can cause kidney stones. Paracetamol, one of the most widely used drugs, is frequently known for hepatotoxicity. NSAIDs, it's one of the commonest misused drugs, Brufen, Vovoran, Diclofenac, you name it. Very commonly causes kidney nephrotoxicity. So I think we all have to be aware, not just the patients, we in the hospital, what drugs to really be careful in terms of, are the doctors over prescribing? Are the pharmacists accidentally prescribing more doses? Are the nurses administering too much? We have to be careful with such drugs. Look at this picture. Now, I don't know how he did it, okay? But I think this is a fake picture, most probably, where you implant one photo onto the other. But whatever it is, there is an inherent risk of riding on a motorcycle. Now, he has made it an external risk by doing this stunt and doing it on a tightrope, maybe 500 meters or 1 kilometer above the skyscrapers. So drugs that way also have drug interactions. Also, that is, you know, all of us, when we add drugs together, they are chemicals, so they can interact. But at the receptor level also, there can be interactions, and that can cause problems. At the liver, when you metabolize or you're degenerating the medicine, again, there might be interactions. All can cause potential problems. If this was a lecture on drug interactions, I would go into it. We have another challenge in India. We have lots of different medical systems. Ayurvedic, homeopathic, Siddha, Unani, you name it. And along with allopathic medicine also. And we really don't know how each works with each other. There's not enough evidence. So we have to be careful with that risk. And most importantly, we are a multicultural society with diverse backgrounds and possibly genetic diverse backgrounds also. And these do affect the medicines and their biotransformation. Let me assure you that. In fact, we've done lots of studies where the South Indian population, the North Indian population, the Northeast population, we've documented differences in the kinetics on certain drugs, certain dangerous drugs. So you'd be careful. But let me just talk from a pharmacy point of view on expiry, just for a brief while. Every drug has a shelf life. So we've got to be careful. We have to note the shelf life in our computer system. And we have to make sure that when we cut strips, that shelf life and that documentation on the strip is not destroyed. I don't know how you're going to do that. That's why I am earnestly asking the government, in whatever capacity I can, that the shelf life should not be on the strip. It should actually be where you don't actually cut the strip, on the opposite side or on a separate paper, which is stuck. But anyway, I can't do anything about that now. But if you do expose yourself to beyond expiry, there is a danger, and that is why we use FIFO, FEFO, etc., which we actually borrowed from food stores, food in, food out. So make sure that the expiry drugs are used first. It's the basic principle. The second aspect is, if you do expire the drugs, what do you do with them? And there are documented WHO guidelines on this, so please go read it up. I'm not here to actually give you information, but just to stimulate your minds, sensitize you, and also hopefully make you think. So please do look up the disposal guidelines for expired medicines. And you'll find that drugs, chemotherapeutic drugs, normal drugs, liquids, all have different ways of disposal. Now let's talk a bit about the external risk in the last few minutes that I have. Medicine misuse and medication error. These four drugs may make a person like this ultimately. Narcotics, and that's why one of the speakers alluded to a double locked cupboard. Steroids, one of the most misused and adulterated drugs, can destroy your entire body without you ever knowing it. I already talked about non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. And again, to me, terrorism, climate change, etc. will not kill us. It's the resistance of antibiotics which is going to kill us. Already people are dying of urinary infections because no drug is working. And who's responsible for that? We, because we misuse antibiotics. Safety. The medication error is classically defined, in my opinion, as inappropriate use or patient harm. And this is the important thing. While medication is in control of the healthcare professional or the patient. So to me, the knowledge, the rules, the actions, and the memories are the most important aspects of the causes of error. But from a practical point of view, this error can occur in any part of the cycle of medicine use in a hospital, whether it's a storage, distribution, prescribing, dispensing, administration, education, use by the patient, any step. But let's just focus on the factors in the pharmacy for a brief while. The first aspect is that you have to have a hospital formulary. You have to identify which are the drugs which are vital, essential, non-essential. You have to try and limit the number of molecules per class. A quick example is proton pump inhibitors, which you use for gastric acidity. pantoprazole, rabeprazole, lansoprazole, esomeprazole, omeprazole, all have the same action. Reps will tell you this is 5 seconds faster in the stomach. So what? Just take one, please. You'll have 1 in 5 less safety issues, I can tell you. Number of brands is an amazing problem. The more number of people you interact with, the more problems there are. Am I right or wrong? Similarly, the number of drugs and the number of brands. And then to top it all, you have to arrange everything by dosage forms. So make sure your formulary is very compact. The storage. To me, pharmacy is one of the most crucial departments, but one of the most stressful departments. And I empathize with all the pharmacists who work so hard to make sure that things move along there. Lack of space, lack of planning in functional flow, the way things are designed. You know, people think that the footprint in a hospital, the pharmacy should be the smallest. So therefore, they make the cupboards this high. And then each time they have to go on a ladder or try and reach for it. And all those things. What about Lhasa, which was alluded to? Names can cause complications. Just look at those two names. Clomipramine, clomiphene. I know the slides are going to go, but I will just end with a few points on this. Dispensing, one of the most crucial things. You know, I've often, you can put the slides off. I've often seen situations where there's a single counter, no partition, and there are four pharmacists there who are having to dispense in that small space. It's not their fault. That's how it's planned. But what happens is, there's no partition, so the drugs are getting interchanged when they're trying to serve it. And not only that, there's a crowd in front of them. Pharmacy is the last queue of the day, my friends. Please remember that. The patients are already sick of standing in all the queues, and here they are rushing and pressurizing the pharmacist to give the medicines out. And they have to comply with that. So often, we are put in a pressure cooker situation because of lack of planning or lack of sensitivity. And finally, a medication error occurs. My dear friends, please remember, the medicine will be put in the pocket and you go home and we don't know what the patient has understood or being communicated. That's an entirely different problem. Unfortunately, the slide has gone off, but I wanted to end with a slide which actually shows a very bad handwriting. I wanted you to actually just decipher it. Okay, this is not my handwriting, even though I have a bad handwriting. Okay, but decipher it. I can't make it out. Now please empathize with these pharmacists who have day in and day out 60 to 70 of these prescriptions. Won't we make an error? Not just that. Every day, anatomy changes once in a million years maybe. Pharmacology and pharmacy change every day because drugs are coming in. Feedback system. And finally, I put this etoprid. A bad mistake happened in a hospital one day because the doctor did not know a particular spelling. I don't blame it. I must have taught the doctor that particular spelling. So, but the fact was that patient, instead of getting etoprid, which was a prokinetic agent, just for gut motility, got etoposide, which is a cancer drug, okay, and because the handwriting is bad, and they mistook it, because it is written etoprid, but it looks like etoposide. For 3 months, child came back bald, not knowing what's happening, but I am not saying this as a blame game, but the fact is it can happen. So we have to look at handwriting. Okay, so have a reporting system, improve reporting, data analysis, and ultimately make sure that our vision in a pharmacy, or as far as medication is concerned, should be to make sure that our understanding, our compassion and our communication is to make sure that the medicines are used as tools of healing. With understanding, with communication, with compassion. If we take these three goals, yes, we will be safe with medicines. Thank you for allowing me that extra 1 minute.
Thank you.